He started creating the Dangote Empire straight out of college. Today, he's the largest producer of cement in Nigeria. His empire includes production of sugar, rice, pasta, and diesel, all things that people just can't live without. Through pure determination and hard work, Aliko Dangote is now placed number 51 on Forbes and is considered the richest man in Africa. We got some young aspiring moguls from all over the continent to sit down with the man. Let's meet our five panelists.
Dangote headquarters. Alhaji Aliko Dangote has agreed to let us into his private office for this interview. So, let's go meet the richest man in Africa. He is Nigeria's very own Donald Trump. He has been listed as number 51 on Forbes' list of the richest people in the world. The News of Africa tags him as one of the 100 most influential Africans. Ladies and gentlemen, join me in welcoming Alhaji Dangote. Thank you very much, sir, for your time.
Thank you very much.
I'd like to start from the very beginning. Say, when you were about a teenager, what kind of kid were you? Were you really into your books all the time, or were you that guy who used to hang out and go to parties?
Not really. Well, you know, I used to, you know, be a little bit naughty, you know, with
really?
Few friends, yes, you know, but, well, you know, I wasn't really mixing with bad guys. I'm always within my own, either relatives or, you know, family, friends. So we all knew ourselves, and, you know, I tried to be very, because my grandfather used to be a very strict person, so I always try to make sure that I don't cross the bounds, you know.
Did you ever think you'd be the 51st richest man in the world and the richest man in Africa? And how does that feel?
Really, no. Not at all. You know, I've never really even thought of making it to the Pops list. That is to start with, but you know, I'm really grateful to God that I'm there. But you know, it is also tough to be there. Mm-hmm. When you are there, then you really, really have to make sure that you don't get thrown out of the list.
And what would you say the key secret to your success has been?
Hard work. I believe that, you know, we're a very focused company. We don't really go into things that we don't understand. You know, any business that I don't understand it well, I don't do it at all. And that's really why, you know, why we are successful.
Mm-hmm. So you talked about hard work. You know, some rumors out there that you work very long hours during the day, in excess of 12 hours a day. So how do you balance both your professional life and your personal life?
To start with, I don't really work 12 hours a day. I think I work at least 18 hours a day.
Okay.
Wow.
Yes, I do.
Wow.
I do.
Okay.
I do. I mean, you know, on weekends, I don't work at all.
Okay.
I'm an artist, I'm a singer, and music is what drives me. So when you have a hectic work schedule, do you listen to music? What kind of music do you listen to inspire you?
It depends, you know, it depends on my mood, really. Sometimes I like to go out there and listen to our local music. I don't know whether you know what it's called, King Sonia Day.
Oh, yes.
There's nobody in this world that doesn't really like to hear music. I'm sure even the late Osama, I'm sure even as fanatic as he was, I'm sure he was listening to music. Yes, you know.
I'm wondering if you can run through some of the key factors that make Africa one of the best places to succeed in business, and maybe some of the things that make it also the hardest place to succeed in business.
Well, Africa, you know, the thing is that most of what you hear about Africa, you know, some of them are actually just hearsay. It's just perception of people that some of them, they are too lazy to find out whether Africa is really good or bad. They must have heard from somebody saying that, look, Africa is not a good place to do business, it's tough. But things have actually changed, and we're the only continent that's really been growing at about 5% of GDP, you know. So the area where you need to go in and invest and make money definitely is, you know, Africa.
So coming from where you were as a young man starting off business and seeing the youth of today, what do you think is the difference between when you started out then and where we as young people are now?
Well, the problem with some of our younger generation today, they just want to jump and see themselves up there, you know, overnight. it doesn't really happen. What you need to do is to be very, very focused as a person and be dedicated to whatever that you are doing. It is not really good for you to now go and try something, then after a month you just say, no, it doesn't work, you jump into something else. I think you need to be very, very focused in what you are doing. Once you believe in what you are doing, you see, you should not take your either business or job as something that you must do. Okay, you must take it as it's part of your hobby. If it's part of your hobby, then you do it better.
In Nigeria, it's assumed that there are just two different classes, just the rich and then the poor. Now, is this because of privatization or corruption, or why is this? And if this is, what can the government or people like you do to build that middle class?
In Nigeria, I think, yes, corruption maybe was actually part of it for not creating that middle class. But if you look at it, power alone can create a lot of middle class in Nigeria. Power, by us just having power. So if the government fixes power in the next 1 or 2 years, you see quite a lot of people coming from the poor segment to that middle class segment. You know, there was a study by, I don't know whether it was Goldman Sachs, by one of the firms, saying that if Nigeria can have one additional hour of power, our GDP will grow to 9%. The potentials here, they are enormous.
This news that Dangote has monopoly over everything and there's no competition, which is not healthy for the country. What's your opinion on that?
Well, you see, the problem is that it's not the question that Dangote has monopoly. Dangote does not really have any monopoly. The difference is that we are a company that actually believe in Nigeria. And because we believe in Nigeria, we always go out there and invest heavily, you know, whereas other people are watching. But as soon as now it gets to a certain point, then people will start screaming, talking about monopoly. There's nothing like monopoly, because there's nothing that we do that we're the only ones doing that product, be it cement, be it flour, be it anything. And the laws are the same. You know, government will always bring regulations that will affect either Dangote or it will affect any other competitor of Dangote. So there's no difference at all. It's not the question that, no, yes, it is a monopoly. It looks like monopoly because people are not investing. If you don't invest, you'll not be forced to participate. But if you invest, then yes, it means that, yes, you know, I mean, it is a fair playing ground where if you decide today as a Chinese company to come into what you are doing, we don't have any powers to stop you. So there's no monopoly at all. But it's just the sheer size of the company that people believe that, yes, it is a monopoly. Once you hear Dangote say, hey, you know, nobody really gets into that kind of business. But it's not so, really. There's nothing like that at all.
I'm doing a master's in public administration at the Harvard Kennedy School of Government. Currently, I'm interning with the Tony Elamele Foundation here in Lagos, in Nigeria. They do a lot of work in the sort of private enterprise area. So they're looking at sort of funding entrepreneurship in Africa, and they sort of see entrepreneurship as the way forward, which is very much in line with my interests.
So if I want to be the next Dangote of Africa, what advice would you give me? What do I need to do to become you?
That's a very, very tough one. You know, maybe I might have to charge you.
Lesson number one.
No, I mean, to be serious, if you want to be the next Dangote, is that you have to have a very big heart. You have to take quite a lot of risk, calculated risk. First of all, you have to make sure that you are honest. You must make sure that you don't destroy the name, you know, because your name is very important. That the most valuable asset that you have going forward. Because if you don't have a good name, even the banks, doesn't matter how big you are, they're not going to touch you.
True.
At all. So you must make sure that you have a very, very good name. And number three, you have to make sure that you say that, look, nothing is impossible. Once you say that, yes, nothing is impossible, it means that you can actually achieve that target. Don't go to it. You need a bit of luck, but hard work. Hard work is key.
Just to wrap up, yeah, what do you think young people can practically do to create change? And I'm talking about a young Ghanaian boy sitting there watching this on television from his sitting room. And after watching the show, what's the next practical step he can take to create change?
Well, the most practical thing is for him to know that, yes, once there's life, there's hope. And he himself, he can make it to the top. You look at a lot of people and say, okay, fine, look, as a young, in fact, you guys, you even have a better future than us because you are well educated. Not only that, you know, I mean, you know, today you are talking of IT, you know, teenagers, where things are much, much, much easy. When, you know, we were growing up, there was even no mobile phones at all. But right now you have Facebook, you have Twitter, you know, everything is there at your fingertips. What we need is that most of you guys, when you finish your studies, you should come back home and also contribute your quota. Because if you don't really come, then it will put us at a greater disadvantage. Yeah. So you have to come back home and also contribute your own quota. That's what will only change Africa. If you keep staying out there, then Africa will never change at all.
Meeting Dangote was inspirational, and I think the one takeaway that I take from the interview was that nothing is impossible. And if a man who's that rich and that accomplished can say nothing is impossible, then what's to stop me?
All right, see that. Thank you.
His advice is very simple.
You can really be whatever you want to be. You know, you just have to work hard at it.
Determination.
Aim really, really high.
Less sleep.
And, you know, pray for a bit of luck.
I definitely learned today that I always have to believe in myself. I have to believe in my dreams, my visions, my goals, and always believe that there's a possibility in everything.